is Go Beyond, the teaching and preaching ministry with Pastor Michael Yuricha. Michael is an international speaker, songwriter, and the senior pastor of the Judah Ministries International Worship Center, located in McKeesport, Pennsylvania. If you are ever in the greater Pittsburgh area, please come and visit us. Let's now join in with the Judah Ministries praise team at the Worship Center.
Yes, God.
All my days on earth I will await. The moment that I see you face to face. 'Cause nothing in this world can satisfy. 'Cause Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry.
Come on, Yvonne, yes.
I said nothing in this world can satisfy. 'Cause Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. Jesus,
thank you.
somebody to step in deeper, step in deeper, step in deeper. Listen, listen, you've been on the outside for too long. You've been in the outer court for far too long. The Holy Spirit is bidding you say, come, 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 come. Draw close, draw close, draw close unto me. Come on, just let the Holy Spirit do what He does. Moving on every heart, changing every life.
Well, praise God, we do have a message to get to this morning. And as we shared in communion, I like to share a word about the blood of the Lamb. Amen. How many of you know we can't talk too much about the blood of the Lamb when, God bless you. Amen. When Billy Graham was just a young man, there was a professor from Harvard told him, he says, man, you're a great communicator and you're energetic, you're charismatic, and you got a great message. And he says, but I got to tell you, you got to be careful not to preach too much about the blood. To which Billy Graham replied, as a young man, he said, I will preach about the blood even more, my brother. Amen. Amen. So this morning, as I said, we shared in the Lord's Supper and we recognized the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, because we must never forget, the Bible clearly says, Hebrews 9 and 22, that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness, there is no remission of sin. And as we will learn this morning, God Himself instituted a blood sacrifice for sin atonement in the first pages of your Bible. And this need for blood sacrifice has trickled down throughout history and throughout the human race on every continent on this earth. Every major religion on earth, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, and others, recognized or instituted some type of blood sacrifice over the centuries. How many of you know, even many cults today, as well as the witch doctors in the jungles of Africa, include blood as a part of their rituals and their ceremonies? Because there's something about the blood. Are you hearing me? But as you know, everything that God creates, the devil creates a counterfeit. But one thing the devil could not counterfeit was that of becoming a virgin-born human being, sacrificing himself and therefore providing salvation for all who will call on his name by his own blood. Come on, are you thankful for the blood of Jesus today? So let's turn back into the first pages of our Bible and look at Genesis chapter 3. I'll begin reading right at verse 1. You're all familiar with the creation. God created Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. He created them male and female. Male and female, He created them. Somebody say amen. There's no confusion there in my Bible. So the Bible says, chapter 3, verse 1, it says, now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say, you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, more accurately, more as God, because how many of you know we should all be like God, but not as God? You will not be as God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Somebody say, then. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Verse 8. Then the man said to his wife, then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to man, Adam, where are you? Verse 10, he answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked. So I hid. And he said, well, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree I commanded you not to eat from? Here goes the blame game. Wasn't me. I've told you this before. We have three sons, but we have four children in our house. The fourth child wasn't me. How many of you know it wasn't me gets blamed for everything? Who left the door unlocked? Wasn't me. Who ate my last piece of cake? Wasn't me. So here we go. All stems right back to Genesis. The man said, it was that doggone, that's the original Hebrew. That's that doggone woman you put here with me, God. It was your fault. She gave me some of the fruit from the tree and I ate it. Then the Lord God said to woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, no, wasn't me. God, it was your fault. The serpent deceived me and I ate. I know I told you this before. The serpent couldn't say anything because he didn't have a leg to stand on. Somebody say amen. So we go to verse 1. The Bible says the serpent said, did God really say these four words spoken by the devil? This one question changed the course of history, church, for the entire human race. The simple challenging of God's word. Now, when Eve replied to the devil, she actually misquoted God. Did you know that? Watch, Genesis 2 and 3, if you can throw that back up there, Caleb. The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat from the tree that is in the middle of the garden. True, God said that. And you must not touch it, or you will die. God never said that to Adam. In Genesis 2, God never said, don't touch this tree. He said, don't eat the fruit. Now, ancient Jewish sages and scholars believe that when Eve opened the door by misquoting the word of God, the devil stepped in. Let me give you an example how that works. Does the word of God say this? This is not a trick question. Does the word of God say this? Does it say that money is the root of all evil? It does not say that. But how many of you heard people say that throughout the years? Even church folk. The Bible does not say money is the root of all evil. It says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. So listen, I just want to encourage you now. I want to encourage you. If your money is causing you to do evil things, please give it to me. I promise you I will not love it. So if that money's causing you to sin and sin, pastor, please take my finances. We do WhatsApp, we do it all. We'll take your credit card. Come on with it, somebody, right? But listen, church, there is nothing wrong with money. Money is neutral. But it's very easy to be dragged away by it and have it become your idol. We see that in our world today. The love of money is the root of all kind of evil. The Bible is full of warnings against putting your trust and your hope in finances because money is directly related to your heart. You know how to take an echocardiogram of somebody, right? Look at their checkbook. Look at their bank statement. Jesus says, wherever your treasure is, what's going to be there? That's going to be your heart. We're preparing our 990, so I'm like looking at some finances here. We gave about 30% of our money last year overseas. 30%. Way more than a tithe. So that's why. That's where our heart is. Are you with me? So we put our money where our heart is, and it's the same for either a corporation or an individual. So God has not called us to be financially poor. This isn't pauper theology. He hasn't called us to be financially rich. He's called us to have our priorities in line. That's why Jesus said in Matthew, seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness. And what? All these things will be added unto you. Now listen, it's wonderful to have a lot of money. How many of you have been broke before? How many maybe even now or it sometimes had a little bit of money? A few dollars. Which one was better? Thank you, my sister. I know I can trust my sister for an amen corner here. It's always better having a few dollars in a bank account. Amen? Why, that you consume it upon yourself? No, that you might bless somebody. Our money is not our own. Come on, church. So we can bless somebody. And listen, all wealthy people aren't wicked. We think because somebody's a multi-billionaire, they're wicked. That doesn't even mean they love money. They just learned how to make it. And they learned how to keep it. How many of you know we could probably do a seminar on saving money one day? Oh, come on, ladies. You know I love you. Just because you walk into the store and it says sale, you don't have to buy it. Can I walk down this trail a little ways? Because I know you ladies love me. God will provide. Oh, here I come. Listen. God says he'll supply all your needs, not your greeds. How many pair of shoes do you really need? You all would have had a hard time with Moses out in the wilderness. You would have had to wear the same pair of shoes for 40 years. Man, I know Moses had some fussing women on his hand. There's DK, is that a shoe store thing? DK, where's the DK out here in the wilderness? These sandals are out of style like 35 years ago and I'm still wearing them. Oh, I got a message in here somewhere, I don't know. Holy Spirit, speak to somebody. Hallelujah. So watch this. Let's look at that passage with Eve, right? She's misquoting the word of God. So the devil, here's what these Jewish sages believe. Come here, Eve, touch the tree. It didn't do nothing, you're okay. Nothing happened, everything's the same. But now, come on, see, God was lying to you. Now come on and try the fruit. Do you see the deception, church? Because if you have a little bit of fruit, it's excellent. It will give you knowledge. It will make you feel wonderful. This fruit is what will really fulfill you. Come on, church, do you see the deception? It's taking that little step. Let me give you another hijacked Bible quote. Watch this. How many of you heard, do everything out of the Bible in moderation? Have you ever heard that? It's nowhere in your Bible. Nowhere in your Bible is it said or is it a concept. Listen to me. Listen, you do not have moderate sex before marriage. Oh, I hope somebody heard that. You don't steal moderately. You don't lie in moderation. Come on, just take a little drink. Just rub the tree. Take a little hit. Take a little snort, a little puff. Hit just a little bit. It won't hurt you. Makes you feel great. Listen, I know you've tried men. Why don't you try women now? Come on, y'all with me. And people are looking for something to satisfy them, and the devil keeps telling that same lie over and over and over again. He's been telling it for 6,000 years. You think by now somebody, at least in the church, would recognize the lie. Listen. I've ministered on the streets since my inception, since my birth into Jesus Christ. I've never met a drug addict. I've never met an alcoholic. I've never met a prostitute that said, oh, this is the way I wanted to live my life. This is what I want. I'm living the dream life. But every drug addict starts out with one shot, one puff. It starts with one drink. The alcoholic doesn't wake up, you know, putting down a fifth of vodka every day. Are you hearing me? No, come here, Eve, just rub the tree. It's deception, church. Here, let me give you a word. Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. Throw that up there, Caleb. It says this, watch this. Don't be deceived. God, not will not, cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh you will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. I don't know about you today, but I want to reap into the spiritual things because I'm looking for eternal life, somebody. I had enough of the flesh. Satan's game plan hasn't changed over 6,000 years. Today he still tries the same strategy. Did God really say, do not lie, or only if it's convenient? Did God really say, don't steal from your company unless you're overworked and you're underpaid? Did God really say, don't sleep with your special friend unless you're in love? Did God really say a man ought not to lie with another man, or a woman ought not to lie with another woman unless the government says it's okay and legalizes it? Oh, is somebody hearing me this morning? The deception is the same today. Did God really say the devil, your adversary, will continue to challenge the word of God in your life? That's why I want to encourage you, Judah, to be the Berean that you need to be, to know this Bible front to back, know it backwards and forwards, so the devil can't throw this lie into you. He uses the same deception. We see it in Matthew chapter 3 and chapter 4. Jesus is baptized. The Bible says the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness. When he was in there, the devil did the same thing. Did God really say? How did Jesus reply? This is important. It is written. Know your legal document. You know this is a legal document. Know your legal document, because he can't argue against the legal document. We need to know the word of God, somebody. Verse 7, the Bible says their eyes were opened, meaning their God conscious, because physically they saw the fruit in verse 6, so they can already see physically, but now because of their God conscious within them, they're now aware of their disobedience, they're now aware of their sin, they immediately try to hide themselves with fig leaves. They try to make atonement for their sin, if you will, because they did not want to be exposed to the judgment of God. Just like some of us, now that we recognize our sin, we try to make atonement with good works. If my good works outweigh my bad, I'll make it into heaven. Hear me when I tell you, let me make that very plain, it's a lie. If I give enough to the poor, if I help at the soup kitchen, if I go to church every week, if I could just kick a couple of bad habits, oh, I'll make it in. Let me say it again, it's a lie. There is, my friend, listen. There is not a large set of scales in heaven that will compare your good from your bad. You cannot work your way into heaven. If we were able to work our way into heaven, listen to me, somebody. Jesus Christ died in vain. My Bible says it is by grace you are saved through faith. It is not of works, lest any man should boast. Sola gratia, grace alone. Sola fide, faith alone. Sola Christo, Christ alone. That's it. It's the only way. We cannot earn our way into heaven. So in verses 8 through 10, they say, well, they hid. How many of you know it's our nature when we screw up? We try to hide. Come on, we can all trace this back to our childhood. It's innate in us. We did something wrong. We felt guilty. We try to hide from our parents. Huh. Because I know you didn't want to hear these words. You better go out there and pick yourself a switch. So when you busted mama's china, ooh-wee. Mama's wrath is coming your way. How many used to put extra pair of pants on when you knew that time was coming? Preparing for judgment day. Hey. So listen, saints of God, we all have a sin conscience, every human being. We talked about that in our study of apologetics, right? We talked about the moral argument. We're all born with a sin conscience because of Adam and Eve. So we're all aware when we sin. But here's the thing. You can either obey it or ignore it. However, if you ignore it long enough, we will become desensitized to the Holy Spirit. If we disregard our sin conscience, if we disregard the word of the Lord and we don't repent, the Bible says this. Watch, don't miss this. Our conscience will be seared as with a hot iron and will give us over to a reprobate mind. Yes. That's scary. Meaning there's no more sin conscience. In Hebrews 10 says that we can only expect a fearful judgment of a hellfire. So here's good news. Now listen. If you're here today and you still have a God conscience and you're still convicted when you're not living right or doing right or talking right, that means the Holy Spirit is still checking you. Come on, you all with me here? Come on, somebody say that's a good thing. Because listen, if you're saved, you're being sanctified. You're being prepared. Honey, you have a wedding to go to. God is preparing his bride. Thank God for his preparation if you're saved. But if you're listening today by this broadcast, or if you're here today and you are not saved, there is still hope. Because where there's breath, there's hope. But that means the Holy Spirit is still drawing you. But listen, my brother, my sister, God's Spirit will not strive with man forever. That's why the Bible says, now is the time of salvation. Because we never know that moment that God's going to draw himself from us. You see that with Pharaoh in the book of Exodus. The Bible, you read that little passage. It said, God hardened his heart. Pharaoh had 9 chances to repent. The plagues, the gnats, the darkness, the frogs. He brought everything to him. And Pharaoh said, no, no, no. So it finally got to the point where God hardened his heart. My friend, I urge you today, if you're here and you're hearing the voice of the Lord, you need to thank God. Do not harden your heart, for today, for now, is the time of salvation. Amen? Amen. But how many of you know God is still calling throughout the earth? It's when we become numb to the Spirit of God, that's when we're in trouble. When we arrive to the point of a reprobate mind, individually or as a nation, and how many know you can clearly see that in our nation today? When we begin to stick our finger in the eye of God and we flaunt our sin, when a society and the federal government begins to take pride in their debauchery. The federal government designates a pride month to celebrate sodomy. When you see these things happen, You know that a conscience has been seared. You know there's a reprobate mind. Don't be deceived. God will not be mocked. God will not be mocked. Let's read on in Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. So they cover themselves with fig leaves. They're hiding from God. God talks to them, finds them. And then verse 21, it says, the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. And the Lord God said, the man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever. So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. After he drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim with a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of life. So in verse 21, the Bible says that the Lord God made garments of skin to cover Adam and Eve, which means some animal had to give up its life. Amen? So God himself made the first sin sacrifice. God himself had to make provision for our sin. And we're talking about the blood this morning. It included bloodshed because they were covered with the skins of animals. Jewish scholars believe that God created Adam on the Temple Mount where there was the first bloodshed. A couple of thousand years later, there was a man named Abraham who went up the same mountain. It's also called Mount Moriah to sacrifice Isaac, his son of promise. And Abraham prophetically stated in Genesis chapter 22 that God will provide himself a sacrifice. That's how God first got his name, Jehovah Jireh, to provide for our sin. We know he provides a whole lot of things. Do I get a witness in the house? He provides for us all the time. But his main provision was that we might be cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. So a couple thousand years, Abraham goes up to sacrifice Isaac. God is known as Jehovah Jireh. A couple of thousands of years past Abraham, oh my God, there was another mountain. There was another hill. It was called Mount Calvary. Is somebody hearing me this morning? It was there that another sacrifice was made on an old rugged cross outside the old city. It was on that hill that the perfect sacrificial Lamb of God was slain. It was there that God sent his one and only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to be offered up as a perfect sacrificial Lamb. It was there, Judah, that Jesus spilled his blood, so that whosoever shall believe and call on the name of Jesus shall be saved. I wish somebody in the house of Judah would give our God a praise right there. Hey! There's power in the blood. Oh, there's power in the blood, somebody. Hey! So we can see blood sacrifice established by God at the dawn of creation. We're talking about the blood of the Lamb this morning. We're talking about a communion. Without the shedding of blood, nada. There's nothing. There's no remission for sin. Jesus said, whenever you do this in memory of you. What was Jesus talking about? Jesus is talking about the Passover meal. We talked about it a little bit during communion. He's talking about the Passover meal back in Exodus chapter 12. Jesus was sitting there with the disciples. They were having their traditional meal, their Seder, and this is what we celebrated today at our communion table. Listen, church, listen. Communion that we celebrated today is an extension of a 3,500-year-old celebration of being set free from bondage, of being set free from slavery. Come on, is there anybody set free? Communion is not just some religious ritual. God forbid. So let me give you an overview. Exodus chapter 12. Most of you are familiar with the story. God sends Moses to get the Israelites out of 400 years of bondage. He goes to Pharaoh, and he pleads with him time and time and time and time and time again. Finally, God says, all right, this is the 10th time. This is the final time. This night, the spirit of death is going to come through. And you need to take the blood of the lamb. And you need to slaughter one. One for each house, he said. He said, slaughter the blood of the lamb. And then you take it and you take some hyssop and you dip it in and you begin to paint the door. Listen, watch. He paints up and then they paint a cross. Oh, come on. Does somebody see the sign I'm making? 3,500 years ago, they were painting the cross of Jesus. Oh, come on, church. The Lord said when the Spirit would come, if he saw the blood of the Lamb, oh, don't miss it. Don't miss that. He would pass over. Here's a good question. Is the door of your heart today painted with the blood of the Lamb? Woo! Once again, church, listen, the shedding of blood is equated to salvation. They had to paint the blood, just like today. We can only escape God's judgment by the painting of the door of our heart with the blood of the Lamb. Now, when God gave them specific instructions in Exodus chapter 12, he said, use the blood of the Lamb, not the blood of a cow. He gave them one way. Did you hear me?
Yes.
There, well, that's your truth. Honey, there's one way. There is no other name under heaven. Oh, come on, does somebody hear me? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. Nobody comes unto the Father, but by me there's one way. It's through the blood of the Lamb. There's not a plan B. There's not a second option. When Noah built the ark, come on, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago. There was one door on the ark. It isn't A, B, or C. No, no. God made it very clear that there is one way. Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, because we're talking about blood this morning. It says, for the life of a creature, here it is in the blood. For I have given it to you to make atonement for yourselves on the altar. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life. In other words, God requires the exchange of a life for a life in atonement for sin or salvation. Since we cannot give our own life, in the Old Testament, God gave us animals. He gave us a substitution. But the Bible says, however, the blood of animals would never completely satisfy. Turn your Bibles into Hebrews chapter 10, the first four verses. This is a real good passage here, saints. Highlight this, underline it, whatever you got to do, mark it. It says, the law is only a skia, a shadow. It means it's a blueprint of the good things that are coming. It's not the realities themselves. Then in verses 3 and 4 it says, but those sacrifices, the Old Testament, are an annual reminder of sins. Because it is, somebody shout impossible. Impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away, to erode sins. Remember when John the Baptist arrived on the scene, when he identified Jesus. He saw Jesus off and he said, behold the Lamb of God who covers your sin. No, behold the Lamb of God who erode, takes away your sin, removes the burden. Listen, when the Jews heard John the Baptist make this proclamation, there was only one reason that a lamb was born in that culture. It was to be sacrificed. So when John the Baptist identifies Jesus as the Lamb of God, oh, come on, are you hearing me here? They understood. Wait. Who is this? Nobody was ever called the Lamb of God before. Who is this guy they're calling a lamb that's going to take away? Because all our sacrifices just covered our sin. But it fulfills the prophecy that when Jesus Christ came and gave himself on the cross, not only would he cover our sin, he would take them and cast them into a sea of forgetfulness. He would take them and throw them as far as it is from the east, as it is unto the west, never to return. Come on, y'all, remember the story when Moses led them out of Egypt. The Bible says that he led them through the Red Sea. Oh, don't miss that. He didn't say the Blue Sea or the Black Sea. Metaphorically, let's call it the Blood Sea. Because when they went through on dry land, the enemy came in from behind them. And they got covered. They went through the blood on the Red Sea. Today, we go through the blood of Jesus. Come out on the other side. Set free. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. My God. Let me wrap this up. Let me wrap it up. Hallelujah. That's a dangerous thing to tell a preacher, honey. That's why they keep me on a clock up here. But we thank God for his blood today. We need to hear the message on the blood. Let us never forget. So let's consider the magnitude of the very first Passover in Exodus chapter 12. Most scholars believe that there were approximately 2 million Israelites when they left on foot. 2 to 3 million. Exodus chapter 12, verse 3, as I already stated, they were to roast one lamb per family. If your family was too small, have a little party with some neighbors. But approximately one lamb will feed about 10 people. Unless you live at our house with our boys, we need 2 lambs per person. Just saying. So you got one lamb per 10 people. Let's do some quick math. If you take 2 million people, 10 lambs per house, I'm sorry, 10 people per lamb, you end up with the first Exodus. There were more than 200,000 lambs sacrificed on that one night. Did you hear me? You know, when we see the little Exodus story, we see one little lamb and a little bit of... Honey, this was a bloody, bloody mess. 200,000 lambs. I did the study. A lamb has approximately a half a gallon of blood in it. So 200,000 lambs would provide 100,000 gallons of blood that were shed just on that first Passover evening. They would celebrate it year after year. They don't sacrifice today. They don't know why. I know why. But they would celebrate it all the way for 1,500 years until Jesus arrived on the scene. But not only did they sacrifice the lamb's blood, but they would sacrifice bulls and goats and pigeons or whatever they could sacrifice. They would spill the blood. It's estimated over the 1,500 years of blood sacrifice on the altar would equate to about 15, listen, million gallons of blood that were shed throughout all those years, through 1,500 years. But I'm here to tell somebody today, all those millions of gallons of blood could not accomplish what just 5 quarts of blood accomplished that came from a Nazarene that hung on an old rugged cross outside the old city when Jesus prayed. All his blood was gone because now because of that blood, because of the blood of Jesus, we have now been set free for all eternity. Come on, somebody, thank God for the blood of the Lamb of God. Hey! When Jesus hung on that cross, arms stretched out wide. This is a miracle in and of itself, because he had no energy. But the Bible says he yelled out, "It is finished." Come on, Judah, like I teach you, that's one word in the Greek. It's tetelestai. It's an accounting term, which means paid in full. When Jesus was sacrificed, the Bible says the veil was rent in two. That was like your bill of sin. Oh my God. It was like Jesus to tell us, "Thy daddy, their sin is paid in full." God took the veil, which kept us from the presence of God, and he ripped it in two. He said, "Come on in through the blood of the Lamb." Oh, come on, is somebody with me today? God, I think I got two scriptures here. I got a couple scriptures here. My. Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. The Bible says they triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. We overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. That's not our testimony that we just talk about. That's okay to do that. But here's the word of the testimony. It's the word of God. Last scripture. Throw it up there, Caleb. Revelation chapter 19. The Bible says his eyes, speaking of Jesus, are like blazing fire. And on his head are many crowns. He has a name written that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed, here it is, in a robe dipped in blood. Jesus is showing his blood sacrifice, and his name is what? The Word of God. It's by the blood and the word of our testimony. The armies of heaven, come on, Judah, this is you. We're traveling behind him, riding on your white stallion, but you are not dressed in blood. You are dressed in fine linen. Come on, I'm talking about wedding clothes here, white and clean. He has made you pure. And out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. I'm telling you, the first time Jesus came, he came as a suffering servant. Honey, but hear me when I tell you, when he comes again, he's coming as a conquering king. On his robe and on his thigh, he has a name that is written. It's a name that's above every name. It's a name where every knee will bow. It's a name that every tongue will confess. Why? Because he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And make no mistake about it, his name is Jesus. Come on, Judah. Somebody praise him in the house of the Lord. Hey! Thank you, Jesus. It's by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Oh, we thank God for his word today. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. He became flesh, and he dwelt amongst us. We're talking about Jesus this morning. Oh, he's worthy, saints of God. He's worthy. Let's never trample the blood underfoot. Oh, that's a dangerous scripture there. I don't know, you better not be faint of heart to go read that in Hebrews chapter 6 and chapter 10. Because it says if you trample his blood underfoot, there's no forgiveness for sin left. That's a dangerous scripture. Because listen, this Bible is a bad news, good news story. The bad news is we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's bad news. People crying, "Oh, we want justice. Social justice, economic justice, racial justice." Honey, listen.
You really don't want true justice. God's book, there's nowhere in there about social justice. It's God's justice. He will rightly divide. Because justice says, I'm guilty as charged. I'm sentenced to death. I'm sentenced to hell. But thank God, I have an adversary. Thank God, I have an attorney. Who's going to step in? Hold up, judge. Hey. His debt has been paid in full. Come on, somebody. So we thank God for the blood. That's why we celebrate communion. That we would never forget what Jesus paid, the price that he paid, that we might be redeemed. Amen. Amen. Come on, put your hands together and stand with me, please.
The power of sin is broken.
Come on.
The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. He has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all.
Come on, shout it out. Hallelujah.
To proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ.